guys acting better. Price me, so I can
Correct. Who's the leader of the Christians in the world? Who's the leader of the Christians in the world? With God's name, the merciful. Benefactor, the merciful Redeemer. We worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, is the messenger of Allah, and he is our eternal leader. It's great honor. Merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. We declare there's nothing worthy of worship except Allah alone. We declare further that Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, 1400 years ago in Arabia, is the messenger of Allah and is our prophet and the last of the prophets. This is the Imam Ali Khan Islamic Center's Ramadan session for 2024. We are so honored and blessed to have with us the distinguished, honorable Hassan El-Amin, Judge, Circuit Court of the State of Maryland, retired, who is going to make a presentation. Without any further, I present to you Judge El-Amin.
And Master Muhammad.
Let me know further, I apologize, this Ramadan session is sponsored by the Nation's Mosque and the Ali Khan Islamic Center. We are so honored to have to be working with the Nation's Mosque under the leadership of Imam Tal Sharif. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Get your juices flowing. We will be referring to the 99 names of Allah, inshallah, somewhere down the road. But the subject, which has been mentioned, it was broached to me, and I was in the process of studying some of this, so I said, well, let's deal with the tafsir of Imam W.D. Muhammad. And that's what's on the board, and that's what we'll get to, and we'll put the 99 names in that context, as the Imam gave us so much. It's like, I would say, the whole universe is his gold mine, because the universe belongs to Allah, and Imam Muhammad tapped into the wellspring of that universe, so it's really infinite. We'll go and see how some of that works. I have a PowerPoint here, which I'm going to, let's see, access. Let me see if I can access it correctly. Yes, okay. I have the first question I want to throw out to you, and there's going to be some questioning and answering. We want to invite your responses. Hopefully they'll be brief. But I'm going to ask you somewhat to tell us who is the most influential single figure in human history. Who is or who was the most influential figure, the single figure who was most influential in all of human history?
Prophet Muhammad.
Well, there are many of those who would agree with you, but why would you say Prophet Muhammad?
If you look at his community across the world, you see his influence today.
Alhamdulillah. Well, there's a very, very learned man who agrees with you 100%, and he wrote a book called The 100. And his book, I have a copy of it here. I can hold it up. It's on the screen. Should it come up?
Yeah, you don't have a slideshow.
Slideshow
will be easier to use.
Right here. There it is. The 100. The author of this book is no gadfly. Dr. Michael Hart holds an AB from Cornell, an LLB. That's a Bachelor of Laws degree from New York Law School, an MS in physics from Adelphi, and a PhD in astronomy from Princeton. He has worked at the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, Greenbelt, National Center for Atmospheric Research, Boulder, and the Hale Observatory in Pasadena. He is currently a senior staff scientist with the Systems and Applied Sciences Corporation in Riverdale, and a member of the American Astronomical Society and Division of Planetary Science. This man concluded that because, as Brother Farouk said, Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, took a backward, illiterate, basically quasi-savage society, and him not himself not being schooled, took it into the furthest corners of the then known world, all the way from Spain to Samarkand and Persia, That's what his followers did. But not only was he successful on a governmental or military basis, he was successful on a spiritual basis. He was responsible for catapulting, I won't say inaugurating Islam, because Islam had been around before, but the codification of Islam and the structure of Islam had not, prior to the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he says on page 10 of his book, "We see then that the Arab conquests of the 7th century have continued to play an important role in human history, down to the present day." Well, what's his justification for that? Arabic, well, who else conquered? Actually, he had a bigger conquest than Muhammad, peace be on him. Who was that?
Alexander the Great.
Alexander the Great? Probably, maybe.
Genghis Khan.
Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan. But Genghis Khan's conquest didn't last, really. They didn't know how to set up government. They misused the people. They abused the people. Whereas the Muslim followers of the Prophet, peace be on him, enhanced the people's lives, right? No war was fought to win Indonesia, and the whole of the Malaysian Peninsula is Muslim. And this writer says, it is this unparalleled combination of secular and religious influence which I feel entitles Muhammad to be considered the most influential single figure in human history.
That is correct. You agree.
I want to say that again. The most influential single figure in human history. So, we don't apologize for trying to follow Muhammad. Do we? We don't apologize for Muhammad. Now, so Time Magazine, clever as they are, they got this and they say, well, wait a minute, we're coming out with our own volume. The 100 most influential people of all time. Right? And who do you think they put as number one?
Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus was not number one.
Paul wasn't it?
Who?
Paul.
Paul? You know, as a matter of fact, I think Hart rates Paul as number four because he says Christianity is the most dominant religion, but Muhammad. Paul had just as much to do with it as Jesus.
Muhammad.
No, they don't put Muhammad first.
Nah.
They politically they know better. But they are very clever. You know who they named as number one? Abraham.
Oh.
Father Abraham.
Very smart.
Smart move, huh?
Very, very smart.
But what religion was Abraham?
Muslim.
He was the one who submitted his will to Allah, right? So he's a Muslim.
He was Muslim.
So we win on both books. Alhamdulillah. So, let me ask you this. With respect to al-Islam, or Islam, how is its growth? Take it from the time that you, for example, first encountered Islam, maybe in the 70s or 80s or even in 2000. What's the fastest growing religion on the planet?
Islam.
And this is something, you know, that you apologize for me. I apologize for using Wikipedia. But, you know, I support Wikipedia. I think it's great. I went to college. I had my mom invested in Encyclopedia Britannica. But to be honest, I didn't like it that much. I still have the Atlas, though, and I use the Atlas all the time. The World Atlas is wonderful. But I used the World Book. Brother Neil Pasha was selling the World Book. Y'all remember Neil?
Oh, yeah.
Where is Neil now? Is he still around?
I'm not sure.
But he was selling the World Book, right? I love the World Book. My sister started selling it too, and she worked with Neil. But I use Wikipedia now, just like World Book. And according to Wikipedia, in the year 2000, there were approximately 200 million Muslims. 200 million Muslims. Now there are upwards of 1.9, some say 2 billion Muslims. We are overtaking the Christian world in terms of population, not in terms of influence yet. Who holds more property than any organization in the world?
Trump.
Trump, you said. No, Trump got a name. You know, he's not going to own it all for long.
That's right.
The Catholic Church.
Yeah.
They got a big trust fund. They own all this church. You know what? I foresee us being able to take over some of those fantastic colleges and universities, campuses. Inshallah, yes, inshallah. With God's help, because the attendance at and support of Catholic Church is diminishing, whereas the support of Islam is growing. What are some of the reasons for that? I'm using the whiteboard. We'll put them on the board. What are some of the reasons for the growth of Islam, that everybody acknowledges is outpacing everything else? As a matter of fact, we had four brothers take shahada a couple of weeks ago, right?
Yes.
I've never seen four. You don't see that at those evangelical rallies sometimes. And imagine that going on in let's say 500 masajid on the East Coast. Small communities. So what's responsible for the growth of Islam?
Become the sense that it makes.
The will of Allah.
Okay, well.
Well, the birth education. Is number one.
Okay, so wait a minute. He stole all the accuracy. Will of Allah. The will of Allah. Okay. But how's that will manifest? Somebody said what?
Education.
Education?
Education.
Education. And how's that? What do you mean education? Do you mean exposure to Islamic? Thought or what?
Education, the Quran, and education of religious.
Dawah?
Yeah.
Okay, so dawah, yeah, because there's a certain amount of Islamophobia around, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, I hope you're not one of those who have fallen for the equation of Islamophobia with so-called anti-Semitism. Mm-hmm. Two different things.
Yes, sir.
Islamophobia is fear of Muslims. I mean, that's what a phobia is. Anti-Semitism, which is a misnomer.
Right, exactly.
Is dislike or a real irrational hatred of Semites.
Right.
Now, Arabs are Semites.
Right, Muslims are Semites.
But the Jews have co-opted that and just snatched it and made it popular, right?
That's right.
So, okay. Education, so you have... Dawah. What else?
Common sense.
Common
sense that Islam makes.
I think the wars and strife.
Okay. All right. So we're going to say reason.
Reasoning.
Reasoning. Yes. Common sense.
You can say popularity too.
Ah, popularity.
Yeah.
What about some of the athletes?
Yeah.
What about Muhammad Ali?
Yeah.
Did he help the image of Islam?
Sure, yeah.
I mean, worldwide. And now we got boxers who are young Muslims who are coming up. I understand we got a champion.
Gervonta Davis, one of the local guys, too.
Yeah. Right. Local, right. He's a world champion, right?
What's his name?
Sugar Shaheen.
What's his name?
Devin
Haney.
So we got celebrities.
Devin Haney.
Celebrities, and you know, in this popular culture, you know, celebrity, I mean, you know, and then we can say, we'll say / social media, okay?
Yeah.
Sports, really, really be.
Can we say sympathy, sympathy, or?
How about family values?
Family values, okay. We've just talked about the problem though. Muslims have the same problems of other families, don't we? I don't know whether we have a monopoly on family values or not.
In a sense that Muslims have not bought into the expanded concepts of gender.
Okay, right. So Muslims have remained fast, and I don't know about you, but we had some readings this Ramadan. We just finished that with the guest of Abraham. And Luke said, "Well, wait a minute, what happened? Take my daughters. I mean, go out with my daughters. Why do you ignore my daughters and you want men?" And they say, "Get away. You want to be holy and stuff. We want what we want." And then Allah turned the city upside down. So, you know, we cannot condone.
And you might add existential need.
Existential need?
No, yes.
Okay, how do you define that, brother?
Existential need. If you see most people, the church can provide any answer for them. The Jews can provide any answer for them. But when they see some of the stuff in the Quran,
uh-huh.
It provides answer.
Okay.
For their own existence, existential need.
So,
because see, if you see the West right now, right? People don't lack no food. They can eat every day.
That's right.
It guarantees 3 meals, correct?
That's right.
But does the church provide any spiritual need?
Well, wait a minute. Hold on. I know you're not talking about the church not providing spiritual need in the middle of Easter season.
Well, it doesn't matter because it's the truth.
I mean, people are going to church. The churches are full up now. People can't wait for tomorrow.
Yeah, but look, how many people used to go to church on Sunday?
Well, I'm saying they are losing population. That's why I say we're going to take over some of these cathedrals, inshallah. But listen, look at our community. Every time a business closes up, who comes in?
Church.
Look at that, right near where we are, Kareem, on Andrews Air Force Base.
Some of the Arabs.
Andrews Air Force Base, and it's the church, and they have Jesus is Lord.
Yeah, right across the street.
What's that?
From the Heart Ministry.
From the Heart Ministry. With Bishop
Cherry.
Bishop Cherry. Pastor Cherry. Did he get his jet plane?
It's his son now.
Oh, son. Did he get his jet plane? Because I mean, they were trying to raise money for the jet. We were trying to raise money for the jet for Muhammad, remember?
Yeah. That's
right. We sent all our money to Chicago.
I remember that.
He got it too.
He got the jet?
Okay. No, Muhammad Ali. I mean, Elijah Muhammad, didn't he?
But now the air
it wasn't
got
a personal jet. Community jet. Mm-hmm. He's talking about personal.
What about the anti-colonial or anti-Western attitude? This has come out about as a result of Gaza. Mm-hmm. We have now. Remember when this opened up and the Hamas stormtroopers went in there and killed, they first said 13, but they went down to 1,200 people, and then they kidnapped 250. I mean, it was atrocious. They shot people in their beds, took the people, and you had the sympathy. President Biden flew over there in about 2 days, and the whole world was shocked.
If you go by their numbers.
That was October 7th.
Numbers, all right, if you go by their numbers.
So, all right, so you go by that number of 1,200, and now what? Over 32,000.
Yeah.
So let's say public
sympathy.
Right. And what has made this possible? You know what's made this possible?
Social media.
Social media, electronic communication. And as we near the day of judgment, it seems to me that everything is becoming more and more obvious. We have less and less privacy, and stuff that you do, that you think is in secret, it might not be in secret.
Cameras everywhere.
That we do. Now, the other, I got one more thing to add, and it kind of, I guess, dovetails with these. And I just call it Tawheed. Tawheed. What is Tawheed? The oneness of Allah. It's inescapable. Has anybody read Megatrends? That's a book that the Imam Muhammad commended. Megatrends. To be honest, I haven't Megatrends, read it. But I know one of the mega trends is toward Tawheed. Who wants to deal with the Trinity? Who can reasonably, who said this? Reasoning, common sense, existential. Who can reasonably reconcile Father, Son, and Holy Ghost? I said that, I asked what that of one of the Episcopalian ministers in the fellowship hall of Masjid Muhammad. When we were doing interfaith, oh, this was some time ago, 10, 12 years ago. And I told him, I said, you know, I was a candidate for divinity school. I had applied for and been accepted to Harvard Divinity and big one. Union Theological Seminary.
You said
seminary. That, look, that was totally okay. So I said, but I had two problems. Number one was, why would the slave or the ex-slave worship the same God as the slave master, especially who treated him so cruelly? Called him three-fifths of a person, whipped him, castrated him, took the mother, separated her from all the children. I mean, and here we are, signing up to that person. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad had the answer. And this is the beauty of having come through that experience by God's grace. Why does the black man love the devil? Why does the prostitute love her pimp? Because the pimp gives her nothing. And she just yearns for that adoration, that love. But he don't give it to her. As long as he don't give it to her, she just loves him more and more. So that's how the white man treated us. That's why you have that embarrassing guy from South Carolina, Tim Scott, signing up to Trump right on national TV. We love you. Oh my God. Didn't y'all just melt? I mean, that was the epitome of capitulation. Oh, Massa, please. Select me. I'll be a good vice president for you. Oh my goodness. Mashallah. But listen, brothers and sisters, this Tawheed is inexorable. The universe is bending toward justice. Allah said he didn't create this for play and sport. It's going toward unity. Under the command of the one God. So, these are some of the reasons you've listed why al-Islam is becoming the world's greatest religion. But it's going to be slow. We won't see, you know, we've seen advances in our time, but it'll be slow. We just got acquainted with Islam, right? Because we got cleaned up a bit by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, then in 70,
Four, here comes Imam Muhammad, and he is off the scene in 2008. But you'll see that we've only scratched the scratch with Imam W.D. Muhammad. There's going to be a lot more, inshallah. Now, here's another question.
That's right.
And I guess I'm leading right into this. Well, first, before I go there, I'm going to go to it, just divert just a little bit, because this is so important. I want to ask you this question. Who, those of us who were privileged to go through the experience of the Nation of Islam and to come out whole, right, and sort of turbocharged, right? Yeah. Turbocharged. We got what was good. We left behind what was too cultish and racist. I mean, you remember they used to say, well, wait a minute, I work with white people. Do you mean to tell me that a little white baby is the devil? Fuel for the fire, sister. Fuel for the fire. We were merciless. For me, who grew up with a lot of white people, I mean, I was frequently the only black person in the class, right? Well, we used to have books back in West Virginia, Fernbank, and I would look in the glossary and see when the word Negro was going to come up. I try to be absent that day. Otherwise, I have like, what's 24 times 2? 48 pairs of beady eyes looking at me.
Really?
Negro, George Washington Carver was the Negro with the peanut. He was a famous. It was sickening, right? Mm-hmm. But, so I knew white people weren't devils. I knew that their history was very devilish, Machiavellian, diabolical history. But you know what? It was like a vacation. For a change, I wouldn't capitulate or give white people what they thought was their due. And there's a saying that Dalai Lama Muhammad says, I cured you of your fear of the white man. So that's what's needed. You know, we don't hate Caucasians. We, at least theoretically and in terms of our existential paradigm, we love everybody, including white people. I mean, there are just the good Caucasians abound. They helped a lot with freedom struggle, with money, with a whole lot of things, principle. But I can't help but think about the clip in the movie Malcolm X by Spike Lee. Remember, Malcolm is descending the stairs outside Harvard University, just gave a lecture. And this co-ed, this pretty white little co-ed, comes up to him and says, Mr. X, oh, your lecture was so good, and we've been following you. We really support you. We love you. What can we do to help you people? What can we do to help your cause? He looks at it and says, nothing. Oh, that cut to the quick. So that's part of why this goes to celebrities. Malcolm X, who would?
Question, was that, but had he actually said that?
He did, he did. That's in his autobiography.
He said he actually told him.
That's in his autobiography. By the way,
he regretted saying
it. I've met Ilyasa Shabazz, his fourth daughter, and she says that the way that she came to know her father most was through the autobiography, because she was too young to really know him. But they love the autobiography. Right. They're not crazy about some of the films. I said, well, how'd you like X, the movie, the Spike Lee movie? You know what she said? She said, well, my daddy was 6'4". And Spike and Denzel, as nice as he is, he was six. He was a lot smaller than my dad. He was okay. But I loved Angela Bassett played Betty. Who plays Betty? Yeah, she said, I love Betty. I love Angela Bassett. And Betty Shabazz was tremendous.
Yes.
A great vocal. Which brings me to the next question. Who was most responsible for the survival of the Nation of Islam? Who was most responsible?
Clara.
Clara Muhammad, he says.
Malcolm,
he says.
You mean after Malcolm? You mean after Malcolm?
Look at the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam was Lost Found Nation of Islam, which was started by Farrar, right, in
Detroit, 1930.
1930, right? And, hold on, I got to go back. That's what I want to show. Without Clara, the FBI would have swooped down on the Nation of Islam and just killed it. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
It was Clara who stood her ground. It was Clara who bailed the Honorable Elijah Muhammad out of jail in Washington, D.C. He was arrested for draft dodging in Washington, D.C. He came down here, and guess what? The ministers suited up, went down to fetch him out. This is in the book, in volume, I'm not sure if it's volume one or volume two. Went down to fetch him out. Clara had put her nickels and dimes together. It took over 6 months to get $5,000. Now, 1930, this is about 1942, so it was in the 40s. It took a long time to get $5,000 together. Sure. She got that, she got those nickels down, and went down to D.C., and guess what? All the ministers who had, and captains and whatnot who had gone to get Elijah out were locked up too. They locked him up too. They said, you trying to get this death dodging jailbird out? Let me see your papers. You jabbed the draft, and they said locked him up. But she bailed Elijah Muhammad out, but a year later he was recharged and sent to the penitentiary in Illinois. So it was Clara. Now you notice the difference in volume one, she's young, right?
Yeah.
Younger. In volume two, she got her glasses on. And brothers and sisters, I don't know how to say it. This is the best book on the history of the Nation of Islam I have ever seen, by far. It reads like, cream cheese on a warm bagel. That's it. With honey.
Know that.
Goes down so good. It's a page turner. You will find yourself turning the page to find, and then you put it down because you don't want to get too much, you know, because you can't wait to get back to it. That's when you have a good read, right?
It's good.
This woman, Dr. Zakiya Muhammad, she has done it. Had I known about this book, had I read it, she passed in, I think, 2019. The book is Pulitzer Prize quality. It's that good. You find out about how penniless and just an economic nothing Elijah was and his family. The Evanses didn't like the Pools. The Pools were dirt poor. Elijah didn't have but the shirt on his back. But guess what? He saw Clara down in, not Sandersville, but another part of Georgia, southern Georgia, sort of middle Georgia. And he came a court every Sunday. He came in his beat up wagon. And I mean, the parents tried to shoo him away, but Clara saw in him something. And after 2 years, eventually she eloped with Elijah. And the pool still, the evidence still didn't want Elijah around until that first child, who was Emmanuel, born in 1921.
Yeah.
Then Ethel. Muhammad Sharif, 1922. Lottie, 1925. Nathaniel, 1926. So the Honorable Elijah Hyman kept her busy, right? Look at 1921, 1922, 1925, 1926. Jabber, Herbert, 1929. Elijah Jr., 1931. Wallace D. Muhammad. Man, Warth Dean Muhammad. But his name and given in the book, Wallace Dulaney Muhammad. Never heard that before. Wallace Dulaney Muhammad. W.D. Muhammad.
Yeah.
Well, Farrar named him W.D. Farrar had a lot of different names. But he wrote
Wallace
on the board. Right? And then finally, Dr. Akbar Muhammad, who was the latest to pass. No, Elijah Jr. was the latest to pass in 2020.
Right.
Nathaniel passed in 2017, along with Lottie. And Dr. Akbar Muhammad passed in 2016. Unfortunately, Zakiya was not able to interview Emmanuel. But she did interview Ethel and Lottie. As well as Nathaniel and Jabber.
Anybody left?
What's the name?
They're all gone.
The youngest one.
No, Akbar was the youngest. He died in 2016.
Oh, okay.
He's gone. This book has beautiful pictures. And it's not all sugarcoated, because the Honorable Elijah Hammond put Clara through some changes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Up in on Woodlawn, South Woodlawn. He had a virtual harem up there.
I know.
I mean, and he would do his thing and then climb into bed with Clara. And Clara withstood it all. She would not criticize him. She just took it.
That's why she said it helped
her physical demise. Yeah. And her advice to her daughters, if you feel something, say it. I held it all in. I didn't want to criticize your father. The Honorable Imam Wallace had the nerve enough to have a seminar in Chicago on the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Dishonorable Elijah Muhammad. He actually stood up and taught that. He was a little upset with his dad. I remember him saying, he said, Dad called him in and said, son, our perfect record is destroyed. You know, there's something about a perfect record. A 99 don't get it, right? It's either 100% or it's imperfect.
So what is he talking about exactly?
When he was talking about it, he talked about his relationship with those secretaries. Because, you know, he didn't marry them, so to speak. And the offspring that he had is some of the reason for the economic destruction of the Nation of Islam. The FBI was counting on it. Yeah. They didn't need COINTELPRO. After they saw what was happening, they said, look, this guy and his estate is going to shred the assets of the nation. Now, Clara, though, kept the FBI off, and they would conspire, of course, with local police. Remember, they were trying to shut down the homeschooling. Now, Claire was a pioneer in homeschooling. Pioneer! Mm-hmm. She wasn't going to send her children to this miseducation system. Sure. You know, and so look at what Claire Muhammad schools don't do, because when you don't have, when you're not worried about, you know, Halloween and the Easter Bunny and Santa Claus and all that mythology and nonsense, you can actually teach.
Yes, right.
And the kids really love it. Our daughter, we have two daughters who went to Sister Claire Muhammad School. Both of them skipped a grade when they went to public school. Mm-hmm. No, because they just were advanced. And we can do this again. We are going to do it again.
Yes, we are.
I don't know how many of you all attended that fundraiser with Brother Omar Kareem, where they raised $15 million. No, $13.5 million. That was a couple of weeks ago, right before Ramadan. They want to have an Islamic school in Prince George's County. I think somebody has seen some property around Woodmore Elementary School. I'm not sure, but that was the word I got. But needless to say, what's lacking is funds.
Right.
You get the funds, you can organize and take care of business. At any rate, so Sister Clara, that's why this great building that just went up on MLK, at 2323 MLK, and as Imam Sharif loves to say, the 23rd surah is Al-Mu'minun. Believers.
That's right.
The believers must eventually win through. If you stick together, apply yourself, you're going to win, right?
That's right.
So, the next question is, I thought y'all might say Malcolm in terms of the survival of the nation. He certainly did a lot, Malcolm and Ali, but it was Clara who stuck it together. Clara fished Elijah off the train tracks out of the suicidal mode, so to take him to the meeting to hear Farrar, to hear the teachings.
That's right.
The teachings are what spurred him to life, right? Invigorated. Yeah. And she took him there, and she nurtured him, and she supported his mission. While he was running around trying to set Messiah up, or mosques, or temples, she was there in Chicago taking care of business. As a matter of fact, y'all know that the Quran got into the prison system, right? How did it get in? You think the white correctional officers allowed this book into the prison? Are you kidding me? Nigga, that's your problem, you reading this crap. That's what they say. You will never get this in there. You can take the Bible.
Right.
We'll give you the Bible. All the Bibles you want. But not that Koran. So Sister Clara started typing portions of the Quran. And whenever she would go to visit Elijah, she would have typed text of the translation, and they were using the Mawlana Muhammad Ali translation. And then one inmate would copy it for another inmate. And sometimes it would come through the mail. But that's how the Quran got introduced into the whole penal system of the United States of America, through Clara. It's a proven fact. It's in this book. One of the many, I'm telling you, this thing is so rich. It's just hard to contain my enthusiasm for it. There's only one copy there.
I got it.
Oh, there was. That's one.
You bring it. Oh, man.
That was a great deal.
That book got sold.
Yeah, it got sold.
It got sold.
You got any more?
No, we don't. We got it
up Amazon.
Masjid Muhammad.
Masjid Muhammad may have some, yes. I think they had volume 2. I'm not sure they had volume 1. But they can get more. I regret if you have to order it online. I had to order Amazon sales. They come real quick.
Thank you.
All right, now, let's go to this. Who is the most influential single figure in contemporary Islamic thought. Contemporary Islamic thought. Who is the most, the single most influential figure? Is it Ahmed Didat? Who, is Ahmed Didat still alive?
No.
No.
But his books and his approach are still very much relevant, right?
Somewhat. They get some young people that are promoting on.
Okay, so who's the, is there a sheikh?
Imam Abdul Muhammad.
That I haven't heard about? Who's the most influential?
Imam Abdul Muhammad.
Correct. It's Imam W.G. Muhammad.
That's right.
Now, we're going to spend a little time with this book. It looks like the Quran, doesn't it? When you look at it, it's not like the binding is like Quran. There's been some criticism of that binding. And rightly so, the binding falls apart. And there's a lot of criticism about this book. This is the first run, okay? This is the first edition. There are a lot of mistakes in here. And there's a lot of room for improvement. I talked to Dr. Nasser Ahmed, myself, about it, and we just laughed together. He's a very warm and hospitable human being. But I know that Dr. Nasser Ahmed, here's Imam Michael Sahir, Imam Ronald Shaheed. I know Dr. Nasser personally. I don't know Imam Ronald Shaheed personally, but I hear so many good things about him. And also, the Imam Yahya Abdullah is on the editing team. Qasim Ahmed, the late Qasim Ahmed, part of the editing team. So these have been called from Ramadan sessions and other sessions, put together in a digest form for access, for convenient access. I want to commend the book.
Sorry, what's the title of the book?
Commentary on Selected Verses of the Holy Quran. Documented from the teachings of Imam Warithuddin Muhammad.
Okay.
Commentary. Now, I'm not sure if W. Muhammad II has this in his on his book list, but I think the copy is sold out.
No, the new one is coming out April 1st.
The new one is coming out
April 1st.
Yeah,
April 4th.
April 4th. All right, okay. So it's going to be snatched up even quicker than this one was snatched up. But this is history.
Yeah.
But it represents the first try. Somebody said they rushed it, and they did.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think it was for compensation. I forget how much this cost, maybe $50. The problem is people are so hungry for the Imam's tafsir and a convenient way to access them, right? That the authors, no doubt, felt pressure, tremendous pressure, to get it done, to get something out. Here you claim to have this great imam, this great mujaddid, and you haven't got anything to show for it. I mean, you got his lectures, and you got his Ramadan sessions, but you don't have a book. He didn't translate the Quran if he'd done that. We would see a lot more, right? This is 540 pages of tafsir, and some of it is just tremendous. I'm going to go through a few examples with to get some ideas. The way to access, the way to read this book, and I suggested to Dr. Nasir Ahmed, and I think he adopted my suggestion, because if you, how, any of you have this book?
Did you say that's on my Amazon?
I don't think so.
It's you can get it.
It's sold out. Like
it's sold out.
You go to nur-alma.org and order it. That's probably Imam Mikhail said here. And if you got any questions, WDM Quran Commentary at att.net.
Okay. I'll write this on the board.
The second question. One, right?
Yeah, that. Yeah, the second.
Yeah, the second one, the new one.
Yeah.
Coming
yes,
out.
The, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so tell me now.
$55.
How much?
55.
Huh?
Nur-Allah.org.
Nur-Allah.org.
Uh-huh. inquiries, WBM, Quran, one word, Q-U-R-A-N,
correct.
Commentary. At att.net.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And that's where the here is.
That's Mikhail Sahir? Alhamdulillah. All right, good. This thing is all jumbled up. You try to read it, you try to go to page one and just read it, it's just a scramble. But its genius and its strength is that it preponderantly or mostly or significantly follows, it tracks the Quran itself. So the way that I've been successful reading this book is to supplement my Quran reading. And if I come to a passage, let's say I'm in Surah 9, verse 29, I can go to this index. This is a Quranic page reference. And if I go to Surah 9, it doesn't have 29 in here, so maybe there's no comment, but it has 107. So I can go to 9107 and see what the Imam said about it. Or I could go to the ninth chapter. That's, I think, the next slide I have. Hold on.
That's a lot of work.
Well, all I can say about that is, in order to get to the jewels, you got to go into the mine. And the deeper you dig, the more you work. You know, anybody can grab, what do they call it? A low-hanging fruit. But a lot of times it's not good.
That's right.
No, this, it takes work. But, and I'll give you an example. Now, we are in the great season of Easter. Hmm. Now, and this dovetails with the 99 names. I'm going to pass these out.
Oh.
All right? Oh. Brothers and sisters, this is the, can I get some help handing these out?
Right here. Okay.
All right. This little humble typed up, I should do this, a mimeograph copy. There are three pages. The first page has the front and back. Front page is front and back.
John. Yeah. That's the back. Is that two copies? Yeah, that's two copies. Give me one of those back.
So there's no Arabic on this particular.
Everybody got one.
Sample. There are the 99 names up with the Arabic, but it's too small to read the Arabic, and this will go from left to right. Rahman Allahi.
You mean right to left?
Right to left, yes. And this is the typical array. But what you've got there, let's look at it. Asma, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Asma Allah Ta'ala. First, Ar-Rahman, the beneficent, the gracious, the compassionate. The traditional translation, Imam Muhammad is the merciful benefactor. Ar-Rahim, the merciful redeemer. Uh-oh. Wait a minute. Redeemer? Now you're treading on my Jesus' territory, right? Because everybody says Jesus is the Redeemer. Because the scenario is God created man, and man started sinning and sinning, and Jesus, God had to send Jesus to give his life to redeem mankind from destruction in hell. And through, if you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then he can exercise his powers of redemption. One of the early things that you read in the Imam's commentary is how we were tricked into believing that Jesus is the Redeemer. What about Allah? Well, the Jews had characterized God as a very vengeful an angry God. And they found it convenient to cast Jesus as the Redeemer. And then the real satanic people who got into the Bible says, well, we're going to make him, make this a Trinity and make him the Son. And when people pray to the Son, they can go through him to get to God. Of course, some of them have to go to the priest to do that. Mm-hmm. Imam Muhammad says on page 27, 26 and 27 of this book, the Quran says, you acknowledge that he, Allah, is Ar-Rahman, but he is also Ar-Rahim. And his giving the bounties that he gave you and giving you that, he also illustrates his mercy. Because to give you so generously, that is kindness, that is mercy, that is love. Wasn't all that established before? This is the argument of Quran, saying, did he not establish before that he loved you? Why did he have to say that he had to come here in the flesh to love you? All of that given before, wasn't that love? So it repeats twice, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahim. There is one God, and he is both God, the Old Testament, God of the Old Testament, and the God of the New Testament, and you have misjudged the God of the Old Testament in his generosity and mercy, and you claim that the second manifestation of him in the New Testament is him. No, he had all that all the time. He has never been without these two mercies. These two mercies have always been with him. He has always been Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. He did not have to come in the flesh of Jesus Christ to establish that he is Ar-Rahman, and he did not have to do it to establish that he is Ar-Rahim. So it is condemning this duality of gods, trinity of gods, really, but the duality, it is challenging directly that there is but one God. The one you misjudge in the Old Testament, you do not see as mercy. You are wrongfully identifying him. He is merciful. He is generous and merciful. Isn't he, by the way, when we say Al-Ikhlas, no, when we say An-Nas, Kula'udi bi Rabbi Nas, so Rab is that guardian, evolver, yeah. Cherisher, maintainer, the one who brings about a thing and then nurtures it?
Yes.
So if Allah is Rabbi Nas, what need do we have a redeemer? Allah is right there. That's my spin on it.
That's good.
He is merciful.
That's a perfect score.
So then who are you going to praise? If you're going to say one of the Jews that God had put himself in and he has come in the flesh of the Jews to save the world, then who are we going to pray to? Israel and Jesus Christ? No, pray to God only. Listen, Imam Muhammad in this book, he kind of castigates the Jews. He gives them a hard time because they set themselves up to be the chosen people of God. And they set themselves up. This not me.
Is this not all? This is not all, right? No, it's not. Okay. No, that feedback on this.
I don't know. They set themselves up to be the dispensers of the religions to the world. You know, Paul of Tarsus was a Jew.
Yes.
Right?
And a rabbi.
He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. But the man makes it clear. Now, when I told my mom, may Allah bless her and be pleased with her and grant her in paradise and reward her for having raised me and tolerated me for so long, I presented this to mom and dad in 1987. It was brand new. You know, I really love this binding on this Quran. And I was sworn in on this Quran on October 24th, 2011. That's what Imam, I suppose, Earl Alameen was referring to. But when I asked, when I was bragging to mom about Muhammad being the most successful person in the world, in the history of the world, you know what she said to me? Well, that might be true, but did he raise himself from the dead on the third day morning?
No, mom.
Touché.
He got you there, huh?
Raise himself. That's pretty good.
Touché. So, you know, Allah is the judge. Accuracy is not nearly as important as sincerity.
No.
See, sincerity is what counts. We can't be accurate. We don't know. We do the best we can. They tell me they just found out that the space is expanding way more rapidly than they thought. And all these space computations got to be redone. They're trying to figure out where the end of space is. And it was Einstein who came up with the genius of discovering that space is curved. Space is curved. It's not flat, it's not straight, it's curved. So, my mom says, on the bottom, return this to Hassan at our death. So, I respected that. I loved that she did that. So she kept it in a place of honor, but then she says, give this back. The Imam's tafsir, here's an example of the tafsir. I love this example.
Why do you think your mother did that?
What, gave it back to me? Because
yeah.
She knew I wanted a book.
I love.
I probably went up to her and asked her for it several times. Or, you know, where is it? What are you doing with it? So she did it because she loved me, I guess, yeah. It's part of it because what good is it going to do her?
All right.
You know.
I'm just curious.
My mom saved me from so much.
Maybe she has some hidden beads.
A lot of
deeper, but I don't know. But it was nice. Appreciate that.
How was she when she
said it? I want, y'all have heard that at the near the end of time, near the judgment day, and let's distinguish between Yom Middin and Yom Al Qiyam. Qiyam is resurrection, right? Stand up, like Iqama, right? Yeah. I mean, it's standing up, according to the Arabic dictionary of the Quran, which is another.
The day of standing.
Yeah. But most of the translators say Yom Middin for the day of judgment. But what is sort of universally acknowledged? Malik Yom Middin, yes. Master of the day, I think he says of religion in this translation.
Yeah.
The Imam says, and per the Bible, the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Right? Mm-hmm. So how do you interpret that? How do, you know, the last shall be first, the first will be last. So we can't wait to approach of judgment day, because we've been last in the line, right? We're the dispossessed. And is it going to become our time to be first? Is that what it means?
We'll be leading the way.
We'll be leading the way.
We're in the Yom Kippur.
Check out what your man W.D. Muhammad said. Scripture says, this is on page 133, as it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. Sound like Bob Marley to me. In the end, huh? That's right. One love, is, I think, is that for, but it's true. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. What was first? The human being was a spiritual life first. Society tells us this, not just Scripture. You study the history of developing society and the history of mankind or the communities of people, and you will find that the first leaders were spiritual leaders. And in so-called primitive societies, right now, their chief leader is a spiritual leader. Our church is not far behind that. They have not changed from the old baby order of society for mankind. They are still in the baby stage where the spiritual leader is their chief over the president or whatever. He is their chief. He's the boss. Wherever they are, in caves, tents, or whatever, they are under a shaman or a spiritual leader, witch doctor or something, because the spiritual life is the first life, and the leadership that forms for that life is the first leadership. Remember, the first shall be last. Caption, Allah made man from dust to be an industrialist. The first shall be last and the last shall be first. The last for man was industry. He came as a spiritual life and then he got engaged, turned on in his brain to his environment and understood that his life needed to mate with his physical environment to produce wealth, to produce the comforts his wife wanted and so forth. So he engaged his physical environment and he became an industrialist. Allah, when he created man, he created him to be an industrialist. When God says that he made man from the dust, he means to tell you that you are made of material that needs development, and your destiny is to go from dust to industry. So, the last are the industrialists, the scientists. They were not the first. The first were the spiritual guys, the witch doctors, the shaman. I mean, they dictated everything. But now, with this information age, industry has taken over. And if you don't believe it, pull out your cell phone. You can access just about anything. He says, dust is not here, at here. Dust is not staying together. The least little wind can blow it away. But dust, of course, combined with water, can become mud and put into shape. So that's the beginning, he says, of what meant by the first shall be last. Spiritual people will be last. And the last to develop, the industrialists, will be first. Mm-hmm. It's come to pass. The preachers, listen, I like this interfaith stuff, but what good, what impact are they having on governments? That's the problem. That's why John Lennon said in his beatific but somewhat nihilistic song, Imagine, it's just a beautiful song. No religion too. No states, no religion, no need to kill or hunger, no need for one person to lord or over the other. So,
what was it? You said
nihilistic.
What was the first term you said?
Nihilistic.
What was the first?
Well, I said quasi. I said something like
beatific.
Beatific. and quasi. Now it's not quite nihilistic, but it does. It does. Softly condemn religion. Softly condemn government, softly condemn all of these entities that we kill and die for. But Allah knows our nature. Remember, he says in the Quran, we made made it possible for you to fashion coats of mail, bulletproof armor, to protect you from your mutual aggression. He knows how we are. And man is evolving, though. I mean, we don't have to do what the caveman did, right? We don't have to do what primitive people did. We don't have to fight like we fight. And if we take to heart some of the things that Kareem said in terms of echoing what the prophet said, what did the prophet say when they said, he said, how do we avoid hell? Somebody said, avoid anger. They asked him again.
Do not get angry.
He said, avoid anger, right? Do not get angry. A third time, avoid getting angry. Because when you're angry, you do things that are counterproductive. But then you have to spend a whole lot of time making up for lost time. So, this business of Easter and what is going through with the crucifixion, and Imam Muhammad spends a lot of time on the crucifixion, on the upward Sirat al-Mustaqim and the horizontal Sabil, right? Sabil Allah, the path of Allah. He says the Sabil is horizontal, Mustaqim is vertical. The idea is that you ascend up, you get the knowledge, then you bring it back and spread it in society, so making society.
That's the cross.
That's the cross. And the cross is also a symbol of difficulties. Each of us has his or her own cross to bear. Allah says Jesus was not crucified, but it was made to appear. And some speculate that it was maybe Judas who was crucified, or Barabbas. I don't think they know. And I don't know what crucifixion means in those terms. Is it C-R-U-X-F-I-C-T-I-O-N? C-R-U-C-I-crucifixion. Was he actually martyred? The man seems to hint that Jesus, in fact, was martyred, but that his message remained clear, intact, and is preserved by the Quran, taken up by God. It's clear. When Allah says, Jesus, did you teach him to worship you? SubhanAllah, I could never have done that. And the Quran, this is the point that Imam Muhammad keeps making about the Quran. It cleans up everything. It clears up everything. It is the Kitab al-Mubin. Right? And the more we understand it, the more advanced we will become in our, I would say, reconciliation, reconcilement with not only other religions, but more importantly, our own lives.
Quick question.
Yes, sir.
You said that the Imam says that he was, in fact, martyred, that he was?
He seems to, I didn't say he said that. I said, from reading his commentary, it appears to me that he acknowledges that Jesus died the death of a martyr by on purpose. That was already, ordained for him.
So when the Quran speaks of the fact that that did not happen, how do you reconcile that?
He
didn't.
I was going to say that Allah, took him up into himself.
Yeah, Allah said
he was not killed.
He was not killed. He just took him up himself.
But he said,
Now wait a minute. Let's talk about being taken up to himself. You don't believe, do you, that Jesus went up onto the Mount of Transfiguration and was lifted up into the clouds?
No.
How could that happen?
Before we get to that, I'm just trying to reconcile the two. Where the Quran says.
Remember, Jesus was a word.
Was a what?
Word.
Okay.
Kalima.
Right? Yeah, kalima. Yeah. Jesus of Nazareth was a word. We know almost nothing about, historically, his life.
Right.
Except for the three, you know, when he was in the temple, when he spoke as a baby. And you can believe that literally if you want. I don't think that is the the right understanding. Right? That they ask him, how did your mother, have you? She's supposed to be chaste. And he says, I'm a prophet. He's speaking, Aramaic to the people. I mean, that's possible. I don't think that happened. But,
When you say that Jesus went up into the mountain, or he went into the mountain of a transfiguration?
Yeah, you know the mountain, right. Yeah. When Jesus is supposed to ascend it unto heaven in front of people, and he went up into the cloud, just like he's going to come back in a cloud.
All that's metaphorical.
Of course it's metaphorical, but people believe it. These same people believe that Santa Claus can start in...
But it has a connection to reality. All of that has to do with the psyche. And that Jesus went up into the highest aspect of his intelligence, his intellect.
Right.
And he was enlightened as a result of that. So, it's metaphorical, but still, what does it mean to you? How is that a practical application to your life? You have to go up to the highest aspect of your intellect and intelligence to be enlightened and transfigured.
And it always disappointed me that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to
Miraj,
Al-Isra wa Miraj, that Jesus was only on the second level. I'm disappointed. I thought Jesus would be, at least higher than, Aaron.
No, I expect him to be on the third level.
Only Allah knows. It's not up to us to.
But you have to understand the levels.
Yeah, but we don't understand the level what it means.
So.
But all I'm just saying, I'm just confessing that I was disappointed.
Right. Yeah, but hold on.
Because of my orientation to Jesus.
Yeah, but just
tell me, though. I mean, he's saying that.
Well, he's saying that in a sense of humor.
Yeah, but this is what I'm saying.
He understands what George.
We in the West, we are bound to have a linear thinking. And linear thinking will tell you first level must be the lowest, then second, third, fourth. But we need to adopt a spherical thinking that's far beyond. But I think that in the scriptural text, who was first, second, and third have no meaning. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his messenger to his people on the right time to get them out of certain stuff. But whose level is he can... Right now.
All these levels are within yourself. Every one of them.
But the level, to me, the level have
no meaning.
It's
not chronological either.
It's not chronological.
It's not chronological. A linear thinking will tell you level one of the floor is closer to ground. Level 10 is the highest one. That's your linear thinking as a man.
Right. Well, that's true. Allah is the best knower in trying to impose my paradigm or my sentiments on the Miraj is
meaningless.
Frustrating.
It's frustrating because it's meaningless.
It's frustrating because you don't understand it. Right. That's what it's frustrating.
I understand that you understand.
Yeah, Muhammad after Ibrahim, then he ascended. He led everybody in prayer and ascended all the way to the throne.
And then he came back down and established the community.
How long did all that take?
One night.
It took millions of years.
Yeah, but
thousands of years.
Yeah, thousands. But see, one night according
for the human being to
for the human being thinking.
Right.
Okay. One night. But then, how can we get in on the horse and then you live in Mecca? You go all the way to Jerusalem.
I could look it up because he actually explains. He has tafsir on who's Barak and why Barak. That's in the book.
What I'm trying to say is, in a Quranic text, okay, the meaning of how long it takes to go is meaningless.
Yeah.
It means absolutely nothing.
Right. It's like Laylatul Qadr.
Yes.
It says it's better than 1,000 months. So the literalist divides 1,000 by 12, and it comes out to 83, and says this is a lifetime. That, to me, is baby understanding. It might be.
It has value.
It has value, but it's missing the point.
What's the point then?
Of what a thousand months is. It's in here again. The man says a thousand months, a year with a lie is like a
50,000.
Yeah, a whole lot. So a thousand months might be 100,000 years.
And a lie don't have no time.
So that business of literally interpreting things does not get you intellectual progress or satisfaction. You got to dig deep. Even the Almighty Muhammad said, look.
I'm not sure if...
Think deep.
I'm not sure if I heard the answer to my question from you. Know.
I have not formulated a
okay.
Succinct answer.
Okay. You did answer the question. You did answer.
I did answer, yes, but not to your satisfaction. I said that the crucifixion was nullified in its desired result because it did not kill Isa or his message. If anything, it enhanced it. And Allah's raising him up means that he saved his message and his mission through the Quran. Mm-hmm. See, it's the Quran that saves Christianity.
Then Allah says, speak not of my servants as being dead, for they are not dead if you only knew.
Right.
So, you know, that's really out in
right. but death. But for people to think that he somehow, that happened to me, I was on a motorcycle trip going to Alaska, believe it or not, going through the cornfields of Indiana. And I had some tune on, I think I had a classical tune on the bike, and I felt like E.T. I was ready to go up. I thought that I might just go up into the sky, but then I thought, it's going to be cold up there. And the average of the oxygen going to give out. Wait a minute. Maybe I don't want to go up there. And then I thought about the ascension and the resurrection and all that stuff. I said, man, there's got to be some different level of truth to that.
And then it's been reported that they see Jesus and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to see them two as one.
Not as one, together.
Together.
Not as one.
But they can't be one.
If they're together, they one.
Not as the same body.
No.
I'm not two.
Oh, okay.
You ought to be rabbi.
Okay, so we only got through Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim.
This is this is beautiful, man. You are doing this awesome.
SubhanAllah, we have
to join. I got a proposal for myself. Take that dash out up there to get to the website. No dash.
But there's one stuff. Sometimes when we read the Quran, right? If Allah doesn't give us a pointer to what he wants us to know, to me, it's irrelevant. Otherwise, he would have clarified.
He says. He reveals it to whom he pleases.
Yeah.
So he did clarify.
Yeah.
Just not to us.
Yeah, not yet. For the thinking man, he thinks, well, how did he get on the real horse all the way from Mecca to Jerusalem in one night? What's the definition of one night? One night probably to us is 8 hours, right?
But that's not a proper procedure. That's how Allah did it for him. But it's all good.
It's all good, but you know.
I wouldn't stress over it.
Now, let me go back to these 99 names.
Yes, sir.
But there's a lot of, hyperbole, I would say, exaggeration. Also kind of a lot of excitement and buzz about the 99 names. When I started dealing with the 99 names, there were very few even mentions of it on the web. But there was just this proliferation now. Everybody's doing the 99 names all over everywhere. And I watched the great Turkish drama of Arturo, Resurrection. It was on Netflix, now it's on YouTube. Arturo. And then the sequel is Osman. This is about the establishment and rise of the Ottoman Empire. While it's not accurate, the stories do represent an accurate development of an empire, which unfortunately collapsed in 1921 because the Turkish foolishly joined Germany, and then they lost control of Jerusalem. The Turks had the holy precincts. They lost it to Britain. And when you lose something to Britain, forget it. And here comes Lord Balfour with the Zionist declaration, and here comes the UN grabbing the territory and just kicking the people out.
That's right.
Just kicking them out. Say, y'all go somewhere. This is our property. And when they fought, they lost. And they've been losing ever since. That is, the Palestinians. But I was going to say, dealing with these names has been one of the greatest blessings of my life. When I was studying and my teacher saw that I was studying, he is Sheikh Haidar from the Gambia. He went into a stutter and almost fainted. Says, Hassan, you don't realize what you're doing. As if to say, this is the beginning of a whole new stage for you. And it is a very, very powerful way to petition Allah to attempt to communicate with or supplicate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it's He who gives Himself these names in the Quran. That's the thing about it. Now, there are some names that are not given literally, but they are implied through the verbs, and so they've been. And all the names are not here. Rab is not here. Rab is everywhere, but it's not here. These names are assembled, I believe, by Tirmidhi, who was a great promulgator of Hadith. Next to Bukhari, and who's the second?
Sahih Muslim.
Yeah, Tirmidhi was great. So here you have them. If you want to learn them, please. Start and just memorize 4 or 5 a day. And it takes a long time. It takes a while. I'll show you some of what it takes. But I was going to, we could do this. We have time. Do the sisters, do y'all have enough light to actually see these?
No.
I got it.
Give them some light. I wanted the sisters to pronounce the Arabic in the first series, the first row, right? And the brothers will do the translation. Then we'll switch. We'll let the brothers do the Arabic name, and then the sisters do the translation. For example, the sisters will say, and I want this on purpose because you are the womb of man, you are the Rahm, right? That's Arham. That's what Rahma comes from, okay? So you guys start with Arahman, and then we will do the translation. When we've done that, then you go to Arahim, okay? Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Arahim.
The gracious, compassionate, the merciful benefactor. Now, the merciful Redeemer, Al-Malik, the King, the Sovereign Lord, the Holy, not Al-Salam, As-Salam, the Peace, the Keeper of Faith, the Bestower of Security, the Faithful. Good try. Al-Muhaymin.
The Protector. The Guardian.
Aziz.
The Mighty.
You did that. Al Mutakabir.
Majestic.
Or 11. Al Khalik, good.
The Creator. The Maker of
Al Musawir, the Fashion. Al Jafar, the Forgiver. Alcohol. Okay, now the brothers are going to do, starting with Al-Wahhab, but I want to pause for Al-Zafar. I've asked Sharif, my teacher, and I've asked several Muslims, imams and scholars, what Allah has many names for forgiveness, so many names, so much more names for forgiveness and mercy than he has for, you know, dominance and power. Of all the names that speak to his forgiving qualities, Al-Ghafar is the strongest because it's the intense form of the active verb, Al-Ghafar. He has Al-Ghafur, he has Atawab, he has other names that mean forgiveness. But Al-Ghafar is so much forgiveness that it's inconceivable to us. That's how much forgiveness there is.
Yeah, but so
I noticed that a lot of ayats in Quran end with El Ghafur Rahim.
Yeah, so right. The word Ghafar here, when you look at the construction, mm-hmm. Okay, it with the Arabic construction, it means a lot of forgiveness that's endless.
Endless, right.
Okay, it's that construction. So once again, when you go to the root verb, when you look at it, then when you call him from this name, he will give it to you.
Right, this is
real.
This is all. Yeah.
All right.
I'm just saying this is form. The way it's written, the transliteration shows it's double F. It would be a form two, which means the cause. You know, causative. Yes. Form two is causative.
Yeah, but say it's
meaning what?
It means that again, he's going to cause you to be given. I mean, so Alama, Mr. Noah, Alama, the cause to know. This is also form two. The way it's written with transliteration, so that way he's going to cause you to be have the. Get granted his forgiveness.
Alhamdulillah. Sure. Then Al-Qahar, with the double H. Okay, now we're going to do Al-Wahhab, and you guys do the English. Al-Wahhab.
The provider, the sustainer. The owner, the believer, the judge.
Okay. Well, okay, let's go through that and we can go back. Let's get, we got roll. I don't want to stop.
El-Kabit. The restrainer, the withholder.
El-Basit.
The extender, the embodier, the spreader.
El-Khafi.
The ambassador.
The abaser. The abaser. One who
bring you down.
Then
Al-Rafi.
The exalter.
Al-Mu'iz.
The honorary, the
treasurer,
the exalted.
Al-Mudir. The dishonor,
the abuser, the humiliated. Yes. Actually, they should end it with U. I mean, Al-Mudir. Al-Mudir. It's fine.
Well, yeah, that's.
It's all good.
Okay. Asami.
The honor, the ear.
Al-Basir.
How
come?
The judge, the equitable.
All right, let's go. The brothers continue with it. Because
I want to point out that El Kahar, Imam Muhammad, taught on that a lot, on that word. The same Cairo, we call it Cairo, Egypt.
El Kahir.
From that same word.
El Kahir, yes.
Imam Muhammad taught on that a lot.
Alhamdulillah, yeah. I've been there too. That's funny. That's
right.
So much changes, language to language. You get the Egyptian spin and, of course, the Fusa, pure Arabic, which is the best, the Quranic Arabic. Okay, Al-Latif.
The title of the gracious.
El-Kabir.
The aware, the all-informed, all-informed,
Al-Halim. Al-Azim.
Al-Azim.
Al-Ghafur. Al-Shakur. Al-Ali. Al-Kabir. Well, this is Al-Hafiz, but Al-Hafiz is what? We're talking about 38.
The preserver, when her, the Quran.
Yeah, the preserver, the guardian, the protector. Mm-hmm. Al-Muqeem.
The nourisher.
Al-Hasim.
The word Al-Hafiz, that's the word we use for someone who memorizes the whole Quran. Al-Hafiz.
The preserver.
Yeah,
yeah. No, but not Al-Hasib. There's another one, the preserver.
Right.
I'll tell you what that is. We'll come across it. Al-Hasib is the record.
Al-Jalil.
Al-Karim.
The bountiful, the generous.
And Al-Raqib.
The watcher, the watchful.
I know a sister Raqib, but she was dead. Watch you. Al-Mujib.
It's their turn now, isn't it? Right.
Yes, okay, you guys get your turn for Arabic. Start with 44 at the top.
Al-Mujib.
The responsive, the hearkener to prayer.
Al-Wasi,
the vast, the all-embracing, the comprehensive, the omnipresent. The wise, the loving. The glorious, El Ba'is, the raiser from death, the witness, the truth. It's the okay. Go ahead. El Wakil, the trustee, the advocate, the representative. Kawi, El Kawi. Okay. Al-Mateen, the firm, the steady. The protecting friend, the patron. The praiseworthy, the laudable. Al-Muqsi, yes, the accountant, the counter. The producer, the originator. Al-Mu'id, Al-Muhyi, the quickener. Okay, you guys can do the next one. This is going well. Al-Mumit, go ahead. The cause of death, the destroyer.
Al-Hayy.
No, let them do this. I'm going to let them continue. Al-Hayy, you did? The alive. Kayyum. The eternal. Self-subsisting. The Al-Wajid. Yeah, make that A long. Al-Wajid. The finder. The revealer. The perceiver. Al-Majid. The illustrious, the noble.
Al-Wahid.
Aren't you supposed to be?
The one. As-Samad.
He's not recognizing.
It says the eternal support of creation.
Yeah.
Now. He's reading that out. He's not
the able.
The able, the capable, the omnipotent. Muqtadir, the prevailing, the dominant, the powerful, the able. Al-Muqaddim,
the promoter,
the expediter, the bringer upward, the presenter. That's a tough one because you got twice. Al-Mu'akhir. Al-Mu'akhir. Say that. Al-Mu'akhir. Al-Mu'akhir. The retarder, the deferrer, the postponer. Al-Awwal. The first, the before. Al-Zahir. The manifest, the outward, the apparent. Al-Batin, the hidden, the inward. Al-Wali, the governor. Okay, now brothers, we'll do this and let the sisters do the English. 77, Al-Muta'ali, Al-Bar, Al-Tawwab, Al-Muntaqim, Al-Afu,
the partner,
Ra'uf.
Ra'uf.
Imam Ra'uf. Alhamdulillah. Malik al-Mulk. Zul Jalali wal Ikram. Zul Jalali wal Ikram. Al-Muqsit. Al-Jami.
The
Zani.
The self-sufficient, the absolute, the independent.
Hold on. Al Jami, you know, that's from, Juma is from Jami. Mm-hmm. Gather.
Jama. Gather.
Okay. And Al Mughni.
The enricher.
Al Muti.
The giver, the bestower.
Al Mani. This gives me chills.
You must have read my...
What's happening is we're reciting the names of Allah. So there's a tension in the air.
Yeah, but the boss himself said, if you want to reach me, use this name. It's clear.
No, I'm saying, but look, Abdar, the distressor, the destroyer.
Hassan, you heard the story of somebody, Imam Muhammad talked about this. I had one of the tapes. The brother said, I know what the D in your name would stand for, Imam. He told Imam Muhammad this. He said, it stands for the distressor. Imam Muhammad told him, well, you know, if you come with truth, you're going to distress those who don't want to, you know.
That's right. Yeah, that's true.
Were you here when I said this name that she came up with in part two, the actual name that he had, Wallace Delaney, D-E-L-A-N-E-Y.
I heard it.
Okay, alhamdulillah. Okay, Adar. Well, that true. I got chills on that one myself. Okay, and Nafi. And Nur.
And Nur.
And Hadi.
Hadi.
Baqi.
The everlasting, the enduring.
Al-Warith.
The heir, the inheritor.
Al-Rashid.
The guide to the high path.
As-Sabur.
The patient.
فَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدِ رَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَرَبِّ الْأَرْضِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَلَهُ كِبْرِيَاءُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ
الله
أكبر.
You all have seen dhikr beads, right?
Yes.
I want to show you the beads that my teacher Sharif and I put together, and they're very powerful. This is not my suba. There are 1,000 beads.
I was about to say it's 100.
Yeah, there are 1,000. And what I love about these is that this is number 500. I went to the hobby store at his instruction. We got the beads. Then we got fish line, which is really strong, to tie these together. And because he was from Africa, the thing about Africans, most people don't realize it, they know how to tie stuff. I don't know, you know, deal with
ropes. Watch about this African here, man.
I know. Do you know how to tie stuff? I mean, you know, I can't even tie my drawstring for my sweatpants. I can't tie it right. But he could take that double thing and tie it off right. So he tied off the knot here. And what's so great about this is that it has like an abacus, right? So after you do 1,000 repetitions,
you pull one.
Then you put one, right? And then you work on the second 1,000, all the way up to 10,000. And then, so that goes here, and that's 10,000. Then you go back for the next 10,000. So this counts up to 20,000. And for, particularly in the Sufi tradition, in the Tijani tradition, it's nothing. You need to do sometimes 18,000 repetitions for of what? An attribute.
For what?
For spiritual elevation and empowerment.
One evening.
You ever see, that's the, like the word Razak, okay? That's the, it's our provider.
Right.
If you're lacking, you sit quietly, Ya Razak, you call in him to give you. You tried it for 30 days and then you called him.
Come on, my brother. Come on,
see what happens.
So
you don't have to take my word. You try it for yourself.
I'm telling you, this is just a tool. Now, here's another very practical benefit of this. I can conceive a million easily. You know why? Because if each of these beads goes out horizontally and has the same number, 1,000, I'll have 1,000,000. Very easy, right? And if the string were, instead of doubled up, we just one, so I have a million. My mind can easily conceive a million. My mind can easily conceive a billion. How? Because each of those strands that goes up, goes out, will go up. So I have a billion beads. I can see that. It's no problem for me to conceive a billion. I just refer to my beads. Now, a trillion is a little harder. But all I need to do, I need a bigger space. And I have my beads going out, I have them going up, and give me 1,000 of those, and I've got a trillion. 1,000 billion is a trillion. A quadrillion, even a little harder, because a quadrillion is a million. Millions. No, or maybe a million billions.
No, it's a million thousand.
No. A million thousands is...
What about six sextillion?
A unit followed by 21 cycles.
Yeah, that's right. That's first resurrection.
But it's true. Because when you start talking about trillion, quadrillion, sextillion, and septillion, you always octillion, yeah, you always add 3 zeros.
Right, right.
So you have something that's, and it's, you know, if it's 9 zeros, that's a billion. So you start with the billion. Yeah, billionaire, billion used to be a lot.
Yeah.
Then they got, I don't know how many billionaires in Washington, D.C. area. They got maybe 100 billionaires. Okay. All right, so we're going to bring it to a close. I wanted to give you show and tell.
Nothing like show and tell.
Good, what's
good job.
Was this? This is 33.
Good job, Jim.
And this is 50.
How long did it take to destroy it? Just you yourself, or was some of your students? Or?
No, just me. It was a labor of love.
Yes.
I mean, you know,
yeah.
I kind of dropped out of the law practice for a while. Bills got unpaid, mortgage, delinquency notices coming in, bothering, freaking out. Don't know who I'm out with that late at night.
Even with your law.
The law is the best knowing. I mean, you know, you go through that, and you never regret it. It's something that you never regret when you devote yourself to the study of Allah and His names. So please keep that and put it with your value. You know, there are, I guess, better, more modern ways. But I'm a paper kind of person, as you see from my struggling with this computer anyway. And I'm just thankful for the person who handed it. I didn't put my name on it. I got it at Masjid Muhammad. I can't remember from whom I got it. But I just remember pulling it out and using it and kind of blowing Sharif's mind when I did. Hold on. So I want to close it out with one thing, and that is this. Imam Muhammad says, and this is to help us deal with the current crisis in the world, for perspectives, the perspective on current crisis, whether it's Israel, Palestine, or Congo, or China, or Russia, Ukraine, Haiti, where now a gang leader is a spokesman. But you know, from what I heard, that gang leader, he made sense. He says, look, y'all got to bring somebody here to help the people. all these military people, all these plans that you have, you got to deal with these common people and have some solutions for us.
Yeah.
So here's page one. Allah created the earth for just ends. خلق السماوات والأرض بالحق. And no matter what man does to make the world unjust, bad, Allah has already made the creation so that the creation itself is going to force man to come closer and closer to justice until there is a just world, a world of justice, of right doing on the part of rulers or government, and so forth, mainly referring to governments, people with power, not the ordinary person. The ordinary person, the common person, is not responsible for the world not being just. It is the obligation of those who are in power to make the world right. The only thing we do is complain and put our pressure on them, and in many places, get killed for doing it. We are blessed to have a system of justice like the United States, and I will say this. The courts have been the only instrument that has reigned Trump in. Of course, he uses those, but the courts have decided against him almost universally. And while there's respect for the courts, there's hope. That's what angered the citizens of Israel so much, because Netanyahu and them want to take away the power of the courts. And once they do that, they can do anything. Okay. Sometimes you do not have to carry it all the way to your alderman or to the councilman. Sometimes the preacher is enough. Just tell the preacher, and the preacher works it out or finds a way to solve the problem. So what this is saying is from the Quran, really, justice has been put into Allah's creation. Justice is in the earth, in the sky, in the way the solar system works. Everything works for justice, and justice is in our nature. When we go against it, we go against our own good nature. Justice is in everything, and Allah's justice is working. If it wasn't for man being created to utilize or make good use of the creation, what's in the ground and what's in the sky and everywhere, justice wouldn't come this fast. Justice would be very slow coming. But because God has made the world the way it is and made our brains and our hearts the way they are, justice comes fast, and justice is going to keep coming. The bigger the world gets and the more man utilizes the forces of nature and the creative things that are in the earth and sky, the faster justice will come.
Allahu Akbar. And that's why we got to study, remember. Don't drop the ball.
Okay, brothers and sisters, thank you very much. You're very rich.
Before we end, we have a delegate.
Tiffany.
Do you recognize me?
No. Not with any jab. Allahu Akbar.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Come on.
Oh, you don't need the microphone, I guess.
Use that microphone.
No.
What, this one?
So, this is
one of your kids.
Thank you. This for Imam Abdullah.
Yes, please.
Come on.
Thank you.
You want to turn this on?
I might should have glasses. Somebody can see. So this is from the Maryland General Assembly, an official citation. Be it hereby known to all that sincerest congratulations are offered to Rauf Muhammad Abdullah in recognition of your dedication and commitment as Imam. Congratulations on 16 years of exemplary leadership as the resident Imam of the Ali Khan Islamic Center of Suitland. May this Ramadan be a blessed one to you, inshallah. Presented on this 29th day of March by Delegate Tiffany Austin of Prince George's County.
Thank you.
I want to thank our great elected official, Tiffany Austin. May God bless her to have many years. And your father.
Tiffany, get a little closer to him.
Your father was Muslim?
Yes.
So she has Islam in her blood. And she's our dear sister. And I want to thank her for this recognition.
She's at home.
And I want to thank you all for sharing this with me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
If I have to frame it, it might be 10 years from now.
I'll leave one and take one.
Okay.
So I can get it framed. Okay.
Okay, that's the same thing?
Yes, this is another copy.
Got two.
So the food is here. First of all, I want to thank Akbar for recommending that we ask the Honorable Judge Hassan El-Amin to be a presenter. His idea was perspicious.
Yeah.
That's one of the attributes. Oh, he's probably, I'm sure it is one of the attributes of Akbar.
Perspicuous. Perspicuous.
He said auspicious.
Auspicious.
No, I said perspicuous. And because perspicuous means to know the future.
Amen.
Who knows the future?
Allah
subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, again, thank you, Judge El-Amin. And I want to thank your dear wife. It's
Mahasana.
Okay, so I want to thank the judge because now you see why he was a judge. I mean, now he's retired, but now you see how Allah has blessed this man, and he has learned, just like the commander, he has learned the 99 attributes. Would you want to recite them for us?
Really quickly?
Yes.
Alhamdulillah. Always pleasure. And I am not going to use the U form because it's a little time consuming. But technically, if I say, Al-Malikul Al-Qudus As-Salam, that's the best way to do it. But the way to do it in time, I'll do it just simply, Ya Rahman Rahim, Al-Malik Al-Qudus As-Salam. Ya Muhminu Ya Mu'in, I can't help myself. Al Aziz Al Jabbar Al Mutakabir. Al Khalik Al Bari Al Musawir. Ya Ghaffar Qahar Wahab. Ya Razak Al Fatah Al Alim. Ya Qabid Al Basir. Ya Khafid Al Rafi. Ya Mu'iz Ya Mudil Al Sami Al Basir Al Hakim Al Adl. Ya Latif Al Khabir. Al Halim Al Wazim. Al Ghafur Al Shakur Al Ali Al Kabir. Al Hafiz Al Muqit. Al Hasib Al Jalil Al Karim Al Rakib Al Mujib Al Wasi. Al Hakim Al Wadud. المجيد البعيد الشهير الحق الوكيل القوي المتين الولي الحميد المقصي المبدي المعيد المحيي المميت الحي القيوم الواجد الماجد الواحد الاحد الصمد القادر المقدر المقدم المؤخر الاول الاخر الزاهر المتين الولي المتعالي البار التواب المنتقم العفو الرؤوف مالك الملك ذو جلال والإكرام المقسط الجام الغني المغني المطيل المالي الدهر النافي النور الحادي البادي الباقي الوارث الرشيد الصبور ولله اسماء الحسنى فاته بها فلله الحمد رب السماوات والرب الارض رب العالمين وله كبرياء في السماوات والارض وهو العزيز الحكيم والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاه والسلام على الرسول الكريم.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you. Thank you.
Very good.
I'm a lake of believers. If I may just have 1 minute, Brother Imam, may I just share two experiences that I had?
Come
on
here so we can see.
Okay. Don't take but a minute. Nothing long and short. Nothing long coupon, nothing like that. I've been blessed to have two major experiences in my life. One of those is I was blessed to be at a Ramadan session like this in Chicago with Imam W. Muhammad before he transitioned. Really a blessing, one of the highlights of my life. Two things I learned at that session that really have helped guide me for many, many years. One, he taught on the jinn, and he blew my mind with that. When he first turned, I heard this term, shapeshifter, okay? Later on in years, I heard it again. That's the first time that I heard him teach on jinn being a shapeshifter. You know, which is, he used an example that I related to personally. I'm a Vietnam veteran. I was exposed to some life and death situations. I always tell everyone I'm proud that I serve, but I'm not proud of the mission. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. Next thing from I got involved in street activity. So I knew when he said dens of iniquity what that meant, because I was around situations that people got killed, people got shot, got robbed. So those were the two dens of iniquity that I related to from that experience. And that was the next thing I learned today. He said, follow things to their logical conclusion. Very important. Follow things to this logical conclusion. That's helped guide me many, many years after hearing that. The next major thing that happened in my life is what, for years, I was blessed to raise three sons, my wife and I. Ironically enough, all three of them had bipolar mental health issues. Okay, so it's always been a trial dealing with that after they got to be 18 years old. So I would pray, I said, Allah, please, give me a sign. I done been through so much stuff. What's happening with that? Yeah. And of course, one revelation was one day I just sat there with the crying in front of me and just opened it up. Wasn't looking for nothing in particular. Opened it up. And you know what it opened up to, saying? Allah puts no burden on you that you can't handle. Mm-hmm. When I read that from the holy book, I said, all right, Lord, what I'm asking for now is just strength to get through this. Help me to understand it. It must be reason for me to get through it. So I got through it. Also in my lifetime, in that prayer, here's how I got the answer. One day when my mother was getting ready to transition, Imam W. B. Muhammad transitioned in 2008 during Ramadan. My mother transitioned in 2009 in Ramadan. I went to the nursing home, visited every shift, because you always want to check out who cared for your loved one.
That's right.
Every shift. My mother loved Surah 23 and Al-Fatiha. Mm. When she heard Al-Fatiha for the first time, she said, you know, I could have come a Muslim. Mm. That mind blow was almost the same thing with my wife. Like Imam Elijah Muhammad's wife pulled him. My wife went to school with a Muslim sister, invited her to the masjid. Of course, she went out. Comes back after one visit. Honey, we need to join the Nation of Islam. But you know what I was doing? Sitting there bagging up my rare for my night trip. Because I was the herb man for years. You want some herb? You come see me. I wasn't no big time dealer, but I was your brother. You know what I mean? So, I'm asking Allah, please give me a sign of what's happening. So that morning, I had read the Quran, read Surah 23, and I'm sitting there about 4 o'clock in the morning. Listen to this. My mother had not spoken for 10 days. Not a word. We know she was getting ready to transition. And I'm sitting there in the chair next to her bed, TV's on, CNN. I had talked to my mother through this whole thing. Mom, I'm going to buy you a dress, blah, blah, blah. For 10 days, she hadn't said nothing, but I'm talking to her for 10 days, all right? Because one morning, she's laying in the bed, hadn't spoken in 10 days. I said to her, Mom, I'm going to sit here, watch the news a little bit before I go. A couple minutes passed. Next thing I know, my mother's head is raising up out the bed. She's staring in the ceiling, just as hard as you can stare. Now you know, my mom ain't spoken in 10 days now. And you know I'm going to ask her a question, even though I don't expect no answer. I said, Mom, what are you looking at? Listen to what she said. Angels. Laid her head back down, passed 5 days later, and never said another word. Was my prayer of answer, my brothers and sisters? Is that some kind of experience to have?
Thank you for taking the time to listen to Steve Jobs.
Oh, before you do that, let me thank Imam Rauf and Akbar for the invitation. And John, I put him through a lot of changes to help get the
he did. Yeah, he did. He didn't hear some of the stuff we left out. But it was a labor of love, but, you know, I mean, there's always a challenge to get yourself together to say something. You don't want to waste people's time, right? So it was, you know, it really had affected my Ramadan, but so worthy, so worth it. And it helped me more than it did you, because I learned some stuff that I couldn't even transmit. Thank you.
Lord, thank you.
Thank you.
So, yeah. Thank you. And thank everyone here, everyone who came and was spending their precious time to come to these sessions. I pray that Allah gives you something from it that is worthwhile, that is helpful, that you can take back with you, that you can share. And these videos will be and are on the internet now, so you can refer to them whenever you like. Imam Rauf, you've been a great friend to the community. You've been a great friend to me. You know, thank you for entrusting us to do what we're doing here. We've got a real great lineup tomorrow. Sister Sadiqa Ali, she is the one I'm kind of expecting the most from, because the conversation I had with her about her presentation was really powerful. So she's got a lot there, and we never hear from her. We never hear from her, but she's, trust me, she's no lightweight. And Sister Farah Shakur, so that first session will be very powerful. And then I could say a lot about Farah too, and you know her as well. And then the second session, of course, Imam Yusuf Salim, the professor and his wife, will be here. And we always love hearing from them. Such a wonderful story from the very beginning, when you hear about how they met and how they were married, et cetera, et cetera. And he is my high school teacher in the Nation of Islam. And Sadiqa was also a student of the University of Islam. So that's going to be wonderful to hear from them. I always love hearing him talk, particularly about his own self, because for years he was selfless. And you know that about him. So, alhamdulillah, I think that we've got a good day today. Thank you again for your attendance. And we're going to close out with Al-Fatiha.
Oh Allah, we cannot manage this life alone without you. Please make of our life what you want it to be, what you prefer it to be. Do not allow us to act on our own. Help us to act only in obedience to you, Allah. We hear and we obey. Forgive us, Allah. We ask for your forgiveness.
Amen. These are to take our trades, okay? You have plates right here, those you want to eat here, but these are to take our trades.
Those are last things,
and we put that in there and we talked about it.
Allahu Akbar.